Hey, hello, Karan.
Hey, hi, Ajit. How are you?
I'm doing good. How about you?
Doing great. So thanks a lot, Ajit, for accepting to speak on this event. And guys, let me welcome Ajit. Ajit is a senior technical marketing manager, developer evangelist, Docker captain, and you know what, AW Arm innovator. You can just add whatever you want to add because he is everywhere. He's everywhere on social media. He's running Collabnix, a great community platform. I'm also there, by the way. If you guys we can share some links to on the chat. But yeah, great community. He's speaking at a lot of various events within India, outside India as well. So Ajit, what are you gonna talk about today? It's about cloud native computer vision applications using Redis. What else we have?
Yes, so the talk is going to be around IoT, artificial intelligence, and cloud native, three topics.
Fantastic. Fantastic, Ajit. All right, the floor is all yours. So walk us through with the with your amazing talk.
Yeah, sure. So let
All right.
me
So yes, your screen is live.
share my screen. Okay, thank you so much. Can you see my screen? Okay.
Yes, okay.
So, okay, fine. Let me go ahead. So thank you, Karan and the team from DevNation. I think you guys have been doing great, inviting a lot of speakers. I have been going through all the sessions and I find it really interesting. So today I am going to talk about building end-to-end cloud native computer vision applications at edge using Redis, because I have been doing a lot of stuff around IoT, cloud native, and artificial intelligence, and I thought that I will go ahead and share it with you guys. So let's get started. A little about myself. I am author at collabnix.com. Collabnix is my personal blogging site with around 300 plus blogs, which I publish almost every week on Docker, Kubernetes, cloud native, and as well as an IoT. So if you are really passionate about learning about containerization, this is the place to be. I'm also a Docker captain since past close to 6 years now. I started using Docker since the time it was born. So you can just imagine that all those 300 blogs are basically, they talk about all the new features which has been introduced in the Docker ecosystem. I'm also leading a Docker Bangalore community group, which has around 10,600 plus members. We do meetups regularly. So if you are really passionate about speaking in any of these meetups, do let me know. I'm also an Arm innovator. It has been the last 1 year I have been being part of the Arm community. And I was also a speaker in the last Arm Dev Summit, which happened in the month of October, where I talked about deep streaming and Docker and IoT, right? And talking about my professional, especially career, I have worked in companies like Dell, VMware, and CGI in the past. And right now, I am working as a senior technical growth marketing manager at Redis. In Redis, I have been handling a developer community where I go ahead and maintain a developer hub site, which you can also visit www.developer.redis.com. And if you are really interested to be part of the Slack channel, so launchpass.com/collabnix is the link which you can click and you can get connected to around 6,200 plus DevOps engineer. Okay, so as I promised, this is going to be an exciting talk. Why? Because you see all of these things in your screen. We are going to play out with drone. We are going to play out with NVIDIA DeepStream, which is again an open source tool. And then IoT edge devices like Jetson, and how all of these dots get connected to build a kind of a powerful solution. So for anyone who is more interested in any of this technology, I know that there has been a lot of questions in the past saying like how IoT edge can help, in artificial intelligence, as well as how it connects to the cloud, right? So this is a talk you should not miss about. Now let's talk about each of these technologies. The first, I will go through the artificial intelligence, then touch upon IoT edge, and then we'll show you how it can be integrated with the cloud native technology. So let's talk about the rise of artificial intelligence. Now, if you look at AI, right, everyone is talking about AI today. If you talk about, especially there has been an explosion of solutions right there in the market, which which basically talks about the deep learning, machine learning, and object detection and analytics. So think of it as like in a smart infrastructure where you are able to track especially the traffic. Based on that, you are able to route your the vehicles in the right direction, right? The other way around is in the retail. If you visit a kind of a hospital's airport, you will see a small robotic platforms which is helping you in guiding in all the queries which you have related to the infrastructure. Talk about the healthcare, how you do a crowd face mask detection system. So AI is being used there, especially about the robotics in data warehousing. Think of it as like a video conferencing when you are in the Zoom channel and then you are speaking at the same time. There has been some kind of a bots which are running in the form of transcript which is captured, right? Those are in one or more like an artificial intelligence, right? In the call centers, if you see, there are automated voice recognition based on your preference, right? Those are being handled. So in one or many ways, there are some kind of a deep neural network which is being used across the industry. And if you think of like if you are an end user, you don't really have to care about it. But if you are really building such kind of a solution, say AI workflow, this is how the typical AI workflow look like. You have some kind of a pre-trained model library. So right now there are a lot of them. I would say like object detection, face mask detection. You have an image classification. You might know about AWS recognition system. That is one way of how you basically recognize the face. You do the face recognition. You have a pose estimation and all of these things, right? These are basically being powered by a few of the pre-trained models which are available right there in the market, right? And usually what we do, we have few of the optimization tools, which we call as in the form of a train, adapt, and optimize. So what we do, basically, we optimize it so that we can get results. Now, think of it as like, if you are doing some kind of a face mask detection system, there is a lot of data which is coming out from those IoT sensor device. Now, you need to get a result out of it. You have to optimize it so that you have all those data which you can play around with. And then that can be basically... that can take place in terms of analytics, how you plot it over the Grafana, how you count the number of people who are wearing the mask can be one of the thing. And then how you detect the object. So one thing which I wanted to share is like I have seen in few of the factories like the water bottle factories, if how they are able to detect whether the bottle is really broken or it is not in the proper shape. So that could be one of the example where you do an object detection and try to find out the data. And at the end of the day, you have a complete report saying like how many of these objects are not in a proper shape and how many you are counting the number of people who are entering the mall, right? So these are the few of the examples where you have a valid data at the end. Now, the challenges with these kind of an AI streaming application is definitely the design, because you might have seen face detection is entirely different from the other type of object detection. You need to have a model which has to be defined. Think of it as like you have an IoT device with a camera module connected in your parking area, and it is able to track whether the vehicle is a car or is a registered car or not, right? So those kind of each and every solution has to be designed in a different way. There has to be a different model. And that is where your all the design complexity. Few of the solutions are more based on TensorFlow, VR, using the PyTorch framework and all this. So we have a multitude of these frameworks, and which comes again with their own set of programming languages, right? Today you can build using Java, Python, and all those AI-based programming languages, like you can use it. In the second way, we are also talking about the cost. So think of it as like you have an IoT edge device, you are in a, and with the camera devices, and you are able to track all those devices, right? There is always a total cost of ownership which comes into the picture. It has to be accurate. Definitely there is some kind of performance benchmarking is involved, and those tools has to be purchased to run those benchmarking, right? And the other way around is you have a multitude of these IoT edge devices. You might be deploying it on your Raspberry Pi. You might be running over the cloud. You might be, say, Amazon recognition system. This is like first 5,000 APIs are free, but after that, what? You need to pay for those APIs, and each API is cost you, right? If you are running on the edge devices, it also depends upon the cost. When you talk about the Raspberry Pi, which cost around, say, close to around $30 to $40, and then till the point you have a Jetson Xavier kind of environment, which might cost you around $500, $500, right? So those kind of devices are still available, but you have a more complex software stack sitting on more complex hardware stack, and that is the challenge today. Now, if you look at the implementation side, this is basically the overall graph architecture, how it look like. Say you have a sensor device, you have a sensors which is collecting the data, and then you try to capture it, decode it, do some kind of a pre-processing on top of it, and then you do the inferencing part, where at this is the point where data itself, you make the machine learn things, right? And then after that, you do some kind of a post processing stuff. Now, right to AI inferencing, whatever you see, like a tracking, business rules, and all this thing, it again needs some kind of a GPU capabilities, where you do some kind of analytics and to gain insight, right? Now, we talked about AI. Now let's jump into the edge computing, and that is an important part, because the AI analytics is something which you run on the edge device. So how it is going to look like? So let's get started. Now, one of the things which I'm really excited and, you know, wanted to share, because I have been working in this platform last 2 years, ever since the Jetson Nano has come into the picture. And the reason why I'm talking about Jetson Nano, because it comes with AI inbuilt. The other than that, it also supports all those cloud native applications. So think of it as like a Docker. Docker is by default installed. So when you flash an SD card on Raspberry Pi, you have to install Docker, right? But in this platform, Docker comes by default, and that too with the latest version of Docker, right? So if you look at the features, the moment when I say AI computer, then it might strike your mind that what kind of an AI analytics it does. One of the beauty of this product, it comes with a GPU inbuilt. So you can run all those AI-based application on top, directly on top of Edge. You don't really have to go ahead and buy a server, try to run a full-fledged application, buy a GPU. So it already has a GPU in it. Look at the configuration. This is now a very minimal, small form of Jetson Nano, which is like a 2GB, which costs around $59. And it comes with, say, 2GB of RAM, gigabit, Ethernet. And look at the GPU, like 128 core NVIDIA Maxwell GPU, what it comes. So if you really want to try out few of the application, if you go to collabnix.com, you'll see like there are a number of examples which I mentioned, where I have talked about the face mask detection, object detection, and all of this thing. And that primarily uses a Docker container. And today, Docker supports GPU. So you can run container, and that container will be able to leverage the GPU device. Okay, you can also specify the number of GPUs. You can also go ahead and try to use application. If you really want to go ahead and specify a share, the GPU share, that is also possible today. Now, if you look at the Jetson, one of the thing I think the NVIDIA has done a really great job here is looking at the cost point, because it comes with 2GB and 4GB. But the other thing is, NVIDIA provides you with a kind of a free open source kind of a stack on top of it. Think of it as like this is how the software stack look like. You have a Jetson, on top of it you have some kind of CUDA driver which you have to install it. And CUDA is basically your interface where your operating system talks directly to the GPU, right? And on top of that, you have a Jetpack SDK. This is completely free, okay? When you install an SD card, when you flash an SD card on Jetson Nano, these are the things which comes by default. And these things are really important. If you see the deep learning, multimedia, accelerated computing, all of these things, you get it just on top of your SD card. And this SD card will be minimal, like 16GB to 128GB. It supports more than that, but we have a support matrix which talks about it. And on top of that, what you do, basically, you go ahead and deploy your SDKs, like deep stream SDKs, which is based on GStreamer, and it helps you to have an end-to-end AI streaming application. And that is being used heavily in all those robotic platforms. Today, if you see the most of the food delivery robotic devices which is being used, they heavily use Jetson, right? So this is how the Jetson software look like. So what we don't really have to go ahead and start something, start compiling something from the scratch. If you have ever installed the OpenCV on Raspberry Pi or any of the Jetson device, you will find that it is so tough, right? The thing is, you really have to take care of the Python libraries and all this thing. But with Jetson and the DeepStream, you have everything in place. Now, the most exciting talk on, especially the section of this talk, is especially the DJI Tello drone. Now, I'm not here to market this product, but this is the first product which I came across which basically supports Python. And that is something which is really exciting. With just around like $99, you can get an indoor quadcopter. A quadcopter is more like an unmanned helicopter, right? So it has around Intel 14 core processor. It has a 5-megapixel camera, 80G in weight. So it's very lightweight drone. And the main motivation of having this drone is coming up with more use cases where you make a Tello talk to these kind of an IoT edge devices and build a powerful solution. The Tello drone is today it's available in India. You can always go ahead and buy it. And the beauty of this product is it supports both the Scratch and the Python programming, which means that sitting on my laptop, I can go ahead, control this device. There are different flight modes which I can use it. And look at the maximum flight distance of 100 meters, right? So this is a really good for basically an indoor testing, and that is the reason I started, because most of the drones which you see, those are not non-programmable, right? So not every drones are programmable, but this is the first drone I came across, and then I had one thought in my mind where I can go ahead and test few of the object detection, and I'm going to talk about it, how I built it from the scratch. And let's not forget that it supports Wi-Fi, which means that you just have to, power on. And the moment you power on this Tello drone, it basically the Wi-Fi hotspot gets created and your laptop can be connected to that. Now, one of the last thing which I want to talk about is how this edge device is and how it integrates to the cloud. And this is where you see here the cloud native DeepStream application. Now, DeepStream, as I said, right, it basically provides you with the end-to-end AI edge streaming, AI streaming application. And that is where the moment you have a sensor data, right, or you have a data coming from the video frames of each of these camera modules come to it, you do a bit of pre-processing, inferencing, and IoT messaging. And now these devices has a very tight integration with the cloud. So think of it as like an AWS IoT Greengrass. You might have used some kind of Datadog, plugins to basically send this data from the IoT to the cloud, right? So today, the integration with the cloud can happen in multiple ways. One of the example which I am really interested about is basically the Redis. Now, one of the thing which, if you have attended my earlier talk, you could see like how the sensor data collected by the Jetson Nano has been pushed to the Redis Enterprise Cloud. As in the form of the Redis time series modules. Like we have a Redis time series module at the cloud, and then these data is fetched through the Python script and send it to the remote Redis database. Now today there have been a support of multiple message broker library. And I'm also going to talk about DeepStream 6.0, which is the latest release from NVIDIA, which talks about, again, and free software, which you can use it. And it supports Redis for the first time, which means that whatever the data or the video frames which you are getting from these IoT devices can be pushed directly to those databases. It supports Kafka, MQTT, and then you have a Greengrass. All of these have a very tight integration with the cloud. And the reason why we are sending to the cloud is based on because of the analytics. We want to plot it over the Grafana. We want to have cloud analytics, because that is the 24/7 which you can run it, right? Even though these small devices have very limited in terms of size and shape, because the SD card maximum it can go to 5 GB, not more than that. But at the same time, what you can do here is send those data to the cloud and use the cloud tools, basically the analytics tool, to run some kind of analytics on top of it. Now, this is the other picture which talks about, because this talk is more on the Redis side, I am going to focus on, okay, how Redis fits into the picture, right? So the moment you have a video frames coming from the camera, it is captured, decoded, and the, you know, the AI streaming is handled. But what are the things which happen is these data are coming in a real time, right? It has to be fed somewhere. It has to be saved somewhere. Now, your SD card is not going to save the data which is coming, say, for months and months of time, right? It has to be stored somewhere. And this data is a timestamp. Like every second, the value changes. Think of it as like a sensor device, or think of it as like you are doing some kind of a face mask detection, and this data has to be fed into the cloud, right? And that is where your Redis PubSub and Redis time series come into the picture. Now, Redis time series is basically a database. It's basically a Redis modules which stores the data in terms of a timestamp. And that can be fed into the Grafana to showcase the entire result, saying like how many people have been captured by the camera, or if you do object detection, it also tracks the objects, right? And so the Python application is, it could be running in the cloud or it could be running on on-prem, but the only thing is it has to be sent to the cloud. And definitely the other type of databases which you can use is like, if you are, even for the primary database, you can look at the Redis, but again, you can always use other kind of databases also to store those applications. Now, coming to one of the most popular use case, right? So this is a part of, I don't have a full-fledged demo because it requires infrastructure, but I can go through the steps which I went through. Definitely I'm looking at the time here. But so let's talk about one of the use case which I picked up. This is a very powerful use case. It's already been implemented by a lot number of people, but what I was excited about is how it can be implemented using the DeepStream 6.0, which supports Redis. So most of the solutions which are available over the market or in the GitHub, which you see, it's more like with DeepStream 5.1 when Redis support was not introduced. So this is a kind of a demonstration which I want to do, especially the wildfire detection, which is the drone flying over the forest, or especially is able to track whether there is a fire or not, and based on that it should be able to send the message to the nearby location, or it could be for my demo purpose I use the Jetson Nano, and then after that it is being tracked over any of the analytics tools. So let's get started here. So the hardware requirement is going to be quite simple, because I already talked about it. We have DJI Telo drone, which cost around $99. Jetson Nano, again, you can use 2GB, 4GB. 4GB is recommended because the deep stream takes, because even the SD card takes around 13GB of space. The recommendation is at least have a size of 128GB in your SD card. And then we have an SD card which might cost you around like $20. These Jetson Nano doesn't come with a Wi-Fi module, so you need to buy a Wi-Fi module. One of them is like it comes around $25. So moreover, it will be close to around $250 to $300 if you are just going with a 2GB of Jetson Nano. And then you need a 5-volt 4-ampere power supply and the DeepStream 6.0, which is like freely downloadable from the NVIDIA site. And the whole solution which we are looking out is something look like this. You have a Telo drone, with a Wi-Fi module enabled. Basically, it basically streams the data in the UDP, whereas you have an NVIDIA Jetson with a DeepStream is able to capture, through the RTSP. And then after that, the data is being, pushed into the Redis database for further analytics. So the step one, the first thing is you need to run a DeepStream container. So the moment you flash an SD card on your Jetson Nano device, Docker is already there. You just have to go ahead and pull. And now this image is not available in Docker Hub. It is available on NGC, which is NVIDIA Google Cloud repository. NVIDIA Cloud repository, where you can go ahead and pull this particular image. This image has all the runtime libraries. It's a gig in size. GStreamer plugin on based, because that is a primarily platform which the DeepStream is based on. You have a models, you have a configs, you have a sample application which you can, which is already there in the DeepStream, and that's why it's more fatty. The second step is going to be setting up the Tello drone. And I can show you quickly an example here, which with this very simple code, I am able to fly. You know, it will basically take off and land. So you can also use the move left, rotate, and move forward. But because I was just like testing it indoor, and the way you see it is very, it went up, it stayed in the air for around like less than 1 minute, and then landed, right? So this is a simple code which you can run directly on your Jetson or on your laptop and test it. Now, the moment it is done, then most probably the third thing is you need to be able to stream the video, right? So you take the picture, you stream the video and send it to your Jetson device. And this is the code, which basically does some kind of an object detection. It will detect it, and then it will try to write it to some kind of a file, right? And this is just for a test. But in our testing, what we did is especially the real-time streaming. It's not like saving in a file, but it is more like a real-time streaming. The fourth step is will be like cloning this repo. Once you clone this repo, the it will basically utilize the live stream of the camera. We needed some kind of UDP to RTSP, which is a real-time streaming protocol. So those kind of a conversion. And you will see tellocontrol.py is going to take care of that. And this script will basically start your Tello stream on the following URL. So what we have done here is run some kind of a video directly on top of your laptop, because this was an indoor testing which we wanted to do. And definitely the deep stream today basically uses some kind of a YOLO V3 model detection, file detection model, which we call as the deep stream Hermes. And that will basically detect the fire, and it is going to show on the screen saying like, okay, these are the places. And the way how it is going to do is basically it is going to count the location of where the fire is happening, fire one, fire two, and all this thing. And at the end, you need to push this data to the Redis. And that is where this kind of, you need to go ahead and write this kind of a Python script where you are importing CV2, but at the same time, you are using the Redis queue, providing the Redis IP address, port, and the DB name. Okay, so by default, if you haven't created a database, it basically takes DB0. But definitely, if you are using Redis Enterprise Cloud, you have a database name, you have a module, you have, if you want to really go ahead and integrate with the modules. So by default, these are the modules which can be installed. And if you are using some kind of, say, if you are using DeepStream 6.0, you don't really have to do all these things. You just have to do some kind of a configuration inside it, because it already supports that. But if you are using 5.1, then most probably you have to install Redis server separately. So that's the beauty of DeepStream 6.0. So I'm planning to go ahead and write a blog on top of it, but definitely this is one of the use case which strike my mind, and I thought that I will go ahead and try to do it. But this is primarily a kind of a simple Python script which you can write it down. Now, coming to the last of the session, these are the future works which I am planning to do. I have been sharing about it in the social media, because I want people to get excited and then try to contribute. But these are the things which I have been planned. Like the first thing is integration with the Grafana. So I want to do the Grafana integration in terms of counting how many number of fires. The second thing is I don't want to restrict myself with the one Tello drone. I want to have a multiple input sources and try to test it. So I'm planning to buy a few bunch of them. And then pushing these timestamp data to time series, so that, because today the Grafana supports that, it would be great if we can go ahead and try to test some kind of a solution. So I think I'm done with this. Over to you, Karan. If you have any question, or I am on time.
Hey, thanks a lot, Ajith. Thanks a lot for this great presentation. So we were already in the chat. We were already shipping pizzas and finding new startup ideas based on drones. So thanks for thought-provoking presentation, I would say.
Yeah, thanks. I'm looking at more from the contribution side. Because the reason why I'm sharing on the social media and about what are the things which I have been doing, these things are more exciting, right? I know that there are a lot of talks which happens around the implementation cloud native, but I think this is one good example which we can see the power of the cloud native application, how we are fetching the data from the IoT and sending it to the cloud for analytics.
Yes, definitely. And you know, so drone is also kind of a, think about this as kind of an edge, right? Where you are running some compute at the edge and doing, you need some processing power. You are limited with respect to the form factor. You can't do a lot of, you can't do more RAM and more CPU, those kind of stuff. So you need things like you know, containers running on maybe on a drone chip or maybe on a Jetson that you were showing, or Raspberry Pi for that sake, running Redis to store some memory, and then once they are in contact back to the central location or the hub, they can sync in the data, get the new data information, exchange information, things like that. So this is definitely going to be a very interesting interesting topic for another 5 to 10 years to come down. And let's hope once we have medicines or pizzas or food delivery being done by drones, I guess. Maybe Edson is still, if you're still on, I don't know if Amazon is shipping something or maybe some other startup is shipping something in the US with drones. Is it real thing there?
Well, not in North Carolina. I've heard that they're trying to deliver something in Seattle, but not here, at least.
Not here. Okay. So yeah, I should ask our friends in the Seattle area, where if they're doing something with respect to this. But yeah, interesting technology, and we can see that, you know, edge is meeting with compute and technologies like Docker's and Kubernetes at the edge, and you know, Redis caches at the edge, and you know, 5G coming up. So you know, the infrastructure and the software and the services are there. It's just about, you know, permissions permission from the government who can give us a green flag on this. So fantastic, Ajit, that's a great presentation.